As we go through life, we frequently find ourselves at a crossroad, not knowing which direction to go. That's why it's important that we move forth in the wonders of God's creation and look for wisdom in the light of His Word. God is right here. So in the midst of the decisions of life, trying to determine which way to go, we can seek Him by going on those prayer walks and getting into the wonders of His creation. Job found himself really in a lot of trouble and problems. And we see God really revealing himself at the end of Job through the wonders of creation. But Job declared this in Job chapter 9, where he says, "He, God, is wise in heart and mighty in strength, who has hardened himself against him and succeeded. He who removes mountains and they know it not. And when he overthrows them in his anger, who shakes the earth out of its place and its pillars tremble, who commands the sun and it does not rise, and who seals up the stars, who stretched out the heavens and trampled the waves of the sea." He's saying, what a mighty God we serve. He will give us that guidance. He'll give us that direction. He will lead us. He'll guide us. He'll direct us. And that's why we need to get into His Word, read His Word, and let His power speak through us. So as we're doing that, at the same time, let's turn to Psalm 33, and let's let the Lord further speak to us here through His Word. And let's take a look here at verse 8. "Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of Him. For He spoke, and it came to be. He commanded, and it stood firm." He spoke, and it came to be. He commanded, and it stood firm. We go all the way back to the beginning, Genesis chapter 1. And we see how God spoke, and He brought forth light in the midst of darkness. We see how God spoke and He brought forth all the life that we know it right now as a result of God speaking. And then we go on to John chapter 1 and we see that God spoke and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. That Christ entered into this world, the Son of God, who came to give us life, purpose, and direction as we stand at the different crossroads of life. "As many as call upon the name of the Lord, they shall be called the children of God," the scripture says. Jesus said, "My sheep hear my voice, they know me, and they follow me." So we stop in the midst of all the worry, the fear, the destruction in this world around us. We call upon God at such a time like this for His direction. We go all the way back to the beginning, where we see the Spirit of God hovering over the deep in the midst of the confusion. And we see purpose and life and hope come out of it all. We see that there is hope because God is there. He brought it all into being, and He's going to continue to keep it. And He's going to continue to keep you and me, regardless of what we're going through at this particular time, regardless of the decisions that we need to make. We know that the God that created it all, the God who spoke forth and it came into being, it's the same God that will guide and direct us at this particular time. So regardless of the troubles and the trials and the problems we're facing at this moment, this is not a time to give up. It's a time to give it to God, to experience His light and let Him create a new work within us, to bring light into the midst of the darkness that we find ourselves stumbling in. What a wonderful world that God has created. And if God can create this world, He can certainly give you direction at this moment as you're on the path of life. He'll show you whether to go to the right, to the left, go straight forward. And it's so important, though, that we spend time with the Creator, go out amongst His creation, and read His Word. And as we behold the wonders of His creation, we begin to see in a new and powerful way how God manifests His glory. For example, in Psalm chapter 8, it says, O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is Your name in all the earth. You have set Your glory above the heavens. Out of the mouth of babes and infants, You've established strength because of Your foes to still the enemy and the avenger. When I look at at the heavens, the work of Your fingers, the moon, the stars, which You set in place, what is man that You're mindful of him, and the son of man that You care for him? Yet You've made him a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with glory and honor. You've given him dominion over the works of Your hands. You've put all things under his feet, all sheep and goats and all the beasts of the field and the birds of the heavens and the fish of the sea, whatever passes along the path of the seas. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is Your name in all the earth. Some people hear this and they read this and they don't think of the responsibility that we have to be earth keepers rather than earth breakers. If God has given us authority over His creation, in the same way He gave His Son authority, our Lord Jesus Christ came on earth, and Jesus showed us how to love and how to serve through love, we should be serving creation through love rather than thinking about domination. We should be thinking of stewardship. People think that, well, God's given us dominion over the earth. That means rob, rape, restore the earth. To just rake up all the minerals that they can, cut down all the trees. And as a result, we end up in a self-destructive realm, cutting down all the trees. I can't breathe. I don't have the carbon dioxide absorbed. We don't have a place to shade. I mean, it's just such destruction end up destroying humanity as we know it. And that's why it's so critical at this particular time that we really get into God's Word. And we can see His Word at work in our life. And we can come to Him and we're able to walk in the midst of His creation. And as we do that, we see the responsibility of stewardship. On my daily prayer walks, and I praise God for the variety of parks and some of the trees that have been there for so many years, some almost hundreds of years. But I mean, there's living history books before. They've been through good weather, bad weather, all weather, reminding me of how God is there and the consistent love of the living God. And trees are such a gift. There's like 3 trillion trees, out there. And God, in the midst of it all, reminds us of His canopy of love and the shade that He provides, the love that He gives. And it's just such a blessing as we just behold the wonders of God's creation, recognizing our responsibilities as stewards of such. And then let God speak to us and breathe upon us as man became a living being, as He's created all this around us that we see, that we can hear Him as He speaks to us, as we hear the wind blow through the trees, as we hear the animals scampering through the woods, as we get into God's Word and let His Word speak to us at such a time like this. And this is what we can know in the midst of it all. We can discover the purpose that God has for us. We can discover the direction that He wants us to go. We can see that He has a purpose. He has a direction. And not only does He manifest it through creation, but in the light of His Word, it starts making sense. We got this longing. We desire to learn more from creation, but we reach a certain point. We can just grasp so much of it as we get just a little taste of heaven and beholding all God's beauty and wonder here. So He gives us the rest of the story in the Word. And that's why as we read creation, we also have to read the work of God. The works of God, creation, the Word of God. And as we do that, it becomes clearer to us our purpose, even as we go through changes in life. We discover who we are, what God wants to do in our life. As we get older and a lot of things physically we may not be able to do, all it does is cause us to depend upon God further, that He will show us through the power of His Spirit ways to do it easier, ways to ask for help if we have to, as we begin to have to depend more and more upon Him as He prepares us for heaven itself. So it's so important that we discover God's Word, God's works, and move in the purpose that the Lord has for us. As we experience the victorious power of our resurrected Lord in our lives, we begin to see it unfold. I mentioned trees earlier. Every seed that goes into the ground, Jesus said, unless it died itself, how can it bear forth 100-fold? Whether it's the trees, corn, grain, plants of any type, into the ground, dark and hopeless, out it pops, and the beauty that unfolds through it all. Well, this is all manifested in God's Word. And as we speak of the Word of God, some might say, well, as I go on my prayer walks, as I journey down the various paths, beholding all the beauty of God's creation, what scripture would I relate to this? Well, there's so many throughout the Bible. But the one in particular comes out, this lengthy psalm, Psalm 104, just goes on into all the wonders of God's creation, all the beauty of God's creation. Time doesn't permit for me to take you into the whole psalm, but just some excerpts from Psalm 104, starting at verse 1. Bless the Lord, O my soul. O Lord, my God, you are very great. As we reflect on the victory that Christ provided for us on the cross, we just see how much more true this is even today than it was in the day that it was written. You're so very great. Not only will you hold your wonders in creation, but you did something about the brokenness in creation, the sin factor in not only creation, but in each one of us, by sending your Son, who is victorious over the grave itself, who died on the cross, who rose from the dead. Over 500 people saw him after he rose from the dead. And those that call upon the name of the Lord, they shall be called the children of God and experience his Spirit working in them and through them. Oh God, you are so very great. You're clothed with splendor and majesty, covering yourself with light as with a garment, stretching out the heavens like a tent. He lays the beams of the chambers on the waters. He makes the clouds his chariot. He rides on the wings of the wind. He makes his messengers winds, his ministers a flaming fire. Wow. What a mighty God we serve. I want to encourage you to take your Bible, read it, meditate on it, and go on a prayer walk. There's so many wonderful parks, city parks, county parks, state parks. I mean, just so many in federal parks. I mean, all over places that you can just go and just rediscover the wonders of God in creation. There's so much time spent on the internet. And take the kids with you. I mean, they need to see this. They need to see, experience, and just give God the glory for all that he has created, all that he has done. And combine the beauty and the peace and the meditation within creation, some call it nature, with the Word of God. It says, he set the earth in its foundation so that it should never be moved. You clothed it with the deep as with a garment. The waters stood above the mountains. Wow. What a mighty God we serve. And as I indicated earlier, as we reflect on seeing how every part of creation has a purpose, that it all works together, they call it the balance of nature, the secular humanists frequently do. We see how that works not only in nature as a whole, but even in each organ in our body. We see it as we just stop and think about it. And we see that how do we, and what part do we play in the middle of all of this creation? There's, you start feeling restless, you start feeling anxious, you start feeling upset. Well, it's setting off all kinds of internal spiritual alarms that you need to fall on your knees, talk to the Almighty God that created heaven and earth. Just say, Lord, I'm seeking some direction in my life. I don't know whether to go right to left, down this path, that path. But Lord, I'm coming before you, and I'm asking you to give me direction. And as you're praying, God will bring this to mind, that to mind, this thing to mind. And then jot it down. Sometimes he'll wake me up in the middle of the night and he'll start speaking that way. But as we seek God, he'll show us and he'll give us that direction. And we'll begin to see his word begin to live within our hearts. And we'll begin to know what we've meant to be. We'll begin to discover what we've been created to do. What is our part in all of that creation? God will show us as we walk with him, behold his wonders of creation, and call upon the Lord in the day of trouble. He will hear us and he will deliver us. Still asking God for a direction in life? Get yourself in his word. Go before him. Begin to pray. You get to know him better and better. He says, Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice. They know me and they follow me. He'll give you that guidance. He'll give you that direction through his word and through the wonders of his creation. There's so many other voices out there trying to pull us in every other direction. And that's why it's so important we let God speak to us. And there's so many ways in his word. And it all comes back to the fact that as we behold all of this, we can't help but just praise him. I felt so many things in my heart the other day, but instead of asking for God to do this thing, that thing, and the other thing, I just found myself just praising God. And I began to feel the burden lifted as I began to praise him. And as they conclude the Psalms, you see this, Psalm 148, 149, 150. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise him in the heights. Praise him, all his angels. Praise him, all his hosts. Praise him. Praise him, sun and moon. Praise him, all you shining stars. Praise him, your highest heavens and your waters above the heavens. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for he commanded and they were created. He established them forever and ever. He gave a decree and it shall not pass away. Praise the Lord from the earth, you great sea creatures and all deeps, fire and hail, snow and mist, stormy wind fulfilling his word. Mountains and all the hills, fruit trees and all the cedars, beasts and all the livestock, creeping things and flying birds. Oh, let it all praise the Lord. Let all that hath breath and life praise the Lord. And so, what does God want us to do? He's got a special job for each and every one of us to do. But he also desires that we would just praise him along with all the rest of creation for all that he is doing. And as we do that, we're like practicing for heaven. And what a glorious place to be. Now, if you have no interest in heaven at all, he's not going to force you to go to heaven. I can just tell you, you're not going to be happy in the other place either. But if you have no interest in God now, you're going to be miserable if you were sent to heaven because you don't have any time for him. You don't care about him right now. So he don't want you to be miserable. But there's so many people that have discovered the resurrected Lord. So many people that have let his love come and flow within him. So many people are willing to move among their pride, their independence, and surrender to the creator of heaven and earth, who made it all, who actually desires to not only have us engage in this first creation, but he's preparing us for a second creation, a new heaven, a new earth, an eternity with him. And so all these trials and tribulations are tests to help prepare us for that new creation, the new thing that he's doing in our midst at this time. We may not understand all these changes we're going through, culture changes, societal changes, all this stuff's coming at us one time, but God is preparing us in a special way. So we need to not only know about him, but know him. That's possible as we surrender our lives to the Lord. As many as call upon the name of the Lord, they shall be called the children of God, saying, Lord Jesus, please forgive me for all of my sins. Come and transform me. I want to receive you, Lord Jesus, as my Lord and Savior. I want to walk in the newness of life, experience the purpose you have for me, both now and for all eternity. I ask this, Father God, in the name of Jesus, that you bring forth this change my heart desires at this moment, and fulfill your purpose in me and through me. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.